Hi class, it's Bill Berry with an intro to chapter 3. This chapter talks about decisions and Boolean logic, and it's important stuff, another fundamental building block of programs. So fun stuff, and let's jump in and look at some of the concepts. First of all, we'll talk about how computer programs make decisions, and we'll look at some of the specific keywords that you'll use, specifically if and else. We'll also talk briefly about Boolean expressions. What does it mean to have a Boolean expression? And what are some of the operators that help create those things? And then we'll talk about more complex cases where you have a series of things to figure out that require nesting ifs inside of other ifs, and another choice that lets us make things a little bit easier to read and understand. And again, touch on logical operators and Boolean variables, how do you create and use those, and what are some interesting tricks about those. So hopefully useful stuff, and this will get you going on the chapter. First of all, it's very fundamental to the way computer programs work that they are able to make decisions based on data. Programs that didn't do this, that could only execute a straightforward series of steps, would be pretty boring and would be darn rare. You always have in business problems a need to do one thing in one case and another thing in another case. And any kind of scientific problem has the same, has the same requirements. So a very simple example is if an employee works more than 40 hours, they get time and a half pay. Well, the if statement that we're going to use here works a little bit like you've seen a function definition, in that you start with the if statement and then you put a colon and then you list with indentation all the things that happen if that if phrase is true. So in this case, we put a condition. So if is always followed by one or more conditions, and that in this case is hours is greater than equal to 40. And if that thing is true, Python will do everything that's indented here under the if statement. So in this case, we have pay equals hours times wage, and then we say if hours is greater than 40, then calculate pay again by taking wage times 40, the base pay of 40 hours, and then you do your wage times 1.5 and you multiply it by the difference of the number of hours and 40. So this takes care of that case. It decides whether they need overtime, and then it pays them accordingly. Now, another thing that can be done here, notice in that first case, we wrote it in such a way that we sort of calculated pay twice for the people with overtime, but that's okay. So that worked fine, but we could also have written it using an else clause, because else says, hey, either take the if or you do the else, right? You do one thing or you do the other thing. So in this second example at the bottom, if hours is less than or equal to 40, you just do a simple calculation of hours times wage, and that's their pay. But if it's not less than or equal to 40, if it's anything other than that, it must be above 40, right? Then you calculate pay by using that same formula we used before. So this is a very simple example of how if and else can work together to solve problems. Notice that on the else line, we did not say if else, we didn't say else hours greater than or equal to, or greater than 40, because it was obvious. If the hours were less than or equal to 40, it was already taken care of in the if clause. So we don't have to repeat the logic of, taking the other side of things under the else. So sometimes this logic looks simpler in print than you would have expected, but that's how it works with if and else. Now, we looked at a case in a previous slide where we said hours is greater than 40. Well, how do you construct these use relational operators to construct these Boolean expressions? You'll notice that the concept of hours greater than 40 in the previous example implies the fact that the result of this is either true or false, right? Either hours is greater than 40 or hours is not greater than 40. So these Boolean expressions are ones whose results is either true or false, right? They've sort of boiled down to that truth or falseness. Now, to compare values, a lot of times we're comparing numbers to variables or comparing, whatever. So here are various operators that you can use to describe your situation and do comparisons. You have greater than or equal to, notice no space. Less than or equal to, again, no space. Here's one that'll catch you, and that is if you want to compare whether two things are equal, you don't use a single equal sign, because as you know, equal is used for assignment, right? To assign a variable a value. So when you want to compare equality and do a test for equality, you have to use two equal signs. Luckily, Python will catch that as a syntax error and will call that out to you usually, but you'll have to get used to that fact. And then not equal to uses the and the exclamation point equals, again, smushed together, no space in between. So when you're constructing your Boolean expressions, you have all of these at your beck and call. Now, another thing that's very common is that you have a series of problems that are more complex than a simple if can handle. For instance, read the problem here at the top. You're going to get 1% if sales are 1,000 or greater, 5% if they're 6,000 or greater, 10% if they're 10,000 or greater, of course, zero if it's not 1%, or not $1,000. So one way to do this, if you look at the example on the left, is that you can take care of the first case. If sales is greater than or equal to 10,000, you take care of that case. But otherwise, if it's not, then it must be less than 10,000. So you indent again in the else clause, right? And then you start a new if, right? So you do a series of these things, and you notice that the more of them you have, you get this stair step and it starts moving to the right. It's fine, it works, everything's fine. And then you notice at the very end, there's an else that says, okay, if none of these things were true, the last else says you get no commission because that means sales were less than $1,000. So this works, but it's a little hard to read. And if you have a lot of them, you start encroaching on the right margin. You really start, you know, moving over. And the eyes don't see it as a bunch of parallel things as much because of the stair step indentation effect. So one thing that's provided in some languages, including Python, is this concept of an else if that's joined together. In this case, Python calls it ELIF. And so you'll notice in the example on the right, I do the first test just the same, sales greater than or equal to 10,000. And then the second thing says ELIF, else if, sales are greater than or equal to 6,000. So you notice now that the indentation is completely consistent on all of these, and then you can still have an else at the bottom that says if none of these are true, you get no commission at all. Now, take a minute, pause the video, look at that and understand how the two things are the same. And also pay attention to the fact that you don't have a complex condition on these. On none of these, let's say the second line, In neither case do you have to say else if sales is less than 10,000 and greater than or equal to 6,000, because that's implied, right? If you had, you know, it would have taken this path if the sales were greater than or equal to 10,000. So you know by the fact that you even got to this line that it had to be less than 10,000. So again, the logic here looks maybe simpler than you might think in some cases. You don't have to test both sides of things when you peel them off one at a time. Now notice we're doing it carefully, peeling it off from the top, greater than or equal to 10, greater than or equal to 6. So we're being careful to do them in order, so we make sure we peel them off in an order that makes sense. So that's a little bit about nested decisions and ELIFs. Now, when you're working in making more complex conditions, you're also going to want to use some logical operators. And to put more complex conditions together, you're going to use and or, and not. Those are the three keywords, all lowercase, and or not. Now, as you might imagine, right, you can think of this in English. If you tell your kid you can't have dessert unless you finish your dinner and take out the trash, they have to do both things, right? Both things have to be true before they get the dessert. So these make sense if you think about them, but one of the ways that you see these expressed in books and in computer science sometimes is in truth tables. So you look at the case where if you have two things, X and Y, and then you're looking at what happens when you and them together versus or them together, you'll see the tables that are present here. You might be asked to, you know, to use something like this or to construct something like this to make sure you understand it. So you'll notice, of course, that and is not very forgiving. It only really works in the one case. But or forgives in more cases, right? It lets it be true in more cases. And not just turns everything on its head. If it's true, it turns it into false, and false is true. So more in your book about that. But here are some examples of how this might work. So first, if sales is greater than or equal to 15,000 and previous month sales is greater than or equal to 15,000 as well. Second one is if commission is less than 8,000 and on probation equals true. Obviously that is a Boolean variable. We're going to talk about those in a minute, but that variable on probation must itself contain true or false. Talk about those more in a sec. Then here's a more complicated one. If, parentheses, x is greater than y and y remainder 5 is equal to 0, all in parens, or x is less than 0. So sometimes you need parentheses to make sure the ands and ors are done in the order that you want. So it doesn't make too much of a surprise there. Last but not least, there are variables that you specifically designed to contain only the values true or false, and those are called Boolean variables. And you'll notice that when you assign them to true or false, you use a capital T and a capital F. Those are the keywords true and false. Now, in this example, we can say if hours worked is greater than 40, then we set this variable called worked overtime to true, otherwise set worked overtime to false. So the variable contains true or false, which is very interesting because then later in the program, you can check it with something like this. If worked overtime equals, right, equal, if it's equal to true, then do the following. Now, one thing that I want you to pay attention to here is if you really deeply understand Boolean variables, you would not write the code that's on the left here. So you want to take a pause and think about it a minute and then go on. There's a much simpler way to write this stuff, but to the uninitiated, it looks strange to the eye, but I want you to be aware that it exists. And so I'm going to come over here and let's do a rewrite and see if this makes sense to you. A single line handles all of this stuff. Right? So in this case, a single line that says worked overtime is equal to the result of whether hours is greater than 40. Remember, hours greater than 40 results in true or false by itself, and so we can set that truth or falseness result of that comparison using that relational operator to worked overtime, and then we don't need any of that if-else business over there on the left. So a real programmer would write that line, not those lines over there on the left. Similarly, let's rewrite this guy because a real programmer would not write this either. What would they do? They would simply say, if worked overtime, right? Why? Because worked overtime is already a Boolean variable. It is already true or false. So you don't need to compare it to true to determine whether it's true. It is either true or false natively by itself. So in this case, that's the same thing of just saying, if worked overtime. You want to name these variables carefully so that it's obvious when you look at the name that it's true or false, right? You don't want to say calculate pay or something like that that seems like it should be a calculation or a number. You want to use a name that kind of implies this fact that it carries a true or false with it. Some people will add a little suffix to the end like yes, no, or TF or something like that to let them remind them of that fact. So Boolean variables are really cool, they're interesting. There's a lot of stuff you can do with what you learn in this chapter. We're certainly going to do a lot with it as we move through the programs, and every program you write is going to have some of this stuff in it pretty much. So Boolean variables is an important topic along with the other ones here. Last but not least, that wraps up our topic on decisions. Your book has a lot more, but I wanted to give you a little starter, a little head start to the chapter. Hope that's useful. Let me know if you have questions. If you have any videos that you'd really love to see, like you don't understand something in the book and you'd like to have a little on-demand video, I'll be glad to make that one for you. So let me know or post in the forums. And thanks for watching the video. We'll see you around in forums or online.